enviorment.org. You can listen live that way as well. So we want to talk about a little bit about yesterday, but before we move on, we're going to spend 30 seconds giving our respect and love to the one and only Prince. So we went, you guys heard about it, right? Everybody's heard about the Purple Rain himself. How do you guys feel about that? Everybody's
devastated.
Sad.
Yeah, yeah. Devastated.
Like, everybody's speechless. Nobody said anything.
No, but it's in such a short time, we lost David Bowie, and now Prince. And I actually, really, Prince has hit me harder. The loss of Prince and his music and what he stood for. And well, maybe it was probably because I was in high school, too. But it's hit me hard. Imagine 57, man.
Right. Well, yeah. The thing that, of course, I'm going to start thinking about is he performed his last show in Atlanta, and I'm mad I wasn't there.
But you never know when your last show is. But apparently he was fine. He was well. And they did say he did cancel his tour because he was sick or something. But he went back to Atlanta. You know, the artist that being the artist that he is, he's going to go back to Atlanta. He finished his show. So it's just it's amazing when you think about what he's done for the industry. I mean, he stood up against music industries and major labels and get his, you know, published and his rights. So he was a pioneer in a lot of ways. Touched a lot of people.
And he launched a career.
Right. People as well.
Mm-hmm. Oh, sure.
All right. So, you know, our love and respect goes out to the family, and the whole world is mourning the loss of Prince, another great legend gone. So our love and respect to the one and only Prince. So we're going to talk again. We still need you guys to comment on Facebook Live whether you can hear or not. We're having a little bit of technical difficulties on there. Can you hear? So make sure you're commenting on Facebook Live. Those that are on, can you hear? And maybe they're not commenting because they can't hear me say, can you hear? So last week we had some interesting feedback from our show from last week. We had a text that came in that says, Urban Cafe, keep doing fine works and bringing critical thinking to your listening audience. That was B Mills Jr., aka Shake, the head coach of Tampa Park Titans flag football team. So
thank you, much respect.
Yeah, so now if you guys remember, there was another caller that called in, and we had some follow-up questions for that particular caller. Now, this caller was honest. He had an honest confession on air, but that wasn't enough for him. He took the time out to send us an email after the show, and this is what he said. So I called into the show today, and you asked me, what are you doing to get involved? I said, other than pushing my opinion around, nothing. That really made me think and made me realize I'm not doing anything tangible. So I am asking you, what can I do to get involved in my community to make a difference? I simply don't know where to start. As a white guy, I know I have to be proactive and get involved to make a difference. I don't want to seem oblivious, but I just need a little direction. I appreciate the show and love WMNF. Have a great day, Christopher Miller. So let's give a big round of applause, a big shout out to Christopher Miller for calling in. That was amazing. So not only did, you know, he was honest enough to say what he said on air, but he said, you know what, that's not enough. Why don't y'all tell me? Because I don't want to seem oblivious, but tell me, what can I do to get involved? Jamal?
The first thing I think is, I look at it, I guess, like a test, I guess, problem, where you need to first outline the issues. What's most important in your community and what's most important to you based on your skill set, which you think you can do. After you outline certain issues, then from there, think about how you can get involved in those issues. Like, for example, if you have a high crime rate in your area, well, what can I do to have different meetings, seminars to educate people?
Time out. He said, what can he do tangible? He didn't say formulate a plan. He said, what can he do tangibly? What can he do? So to answer your question, Chris, if any local community center, or if you want to spread awareness, I feel like that in order to actually not just sit up here and talk about a plan, but to actually put a plan to action, go to any local school, any rec center, volunteer your time. If you have any skills that you can pass on, education. You know what? DC, can we bring him to the show? Yes, DCG said, yo, so Christopher, that is an open invitation for you to come by and be a part of a show, and so we can talk to you about different things and what you can do.
All right, Jamal?
Yeah, well, once again, I'm sorry, I'd have to disagree with that, because once again, it's based on what's needed in your community. Just going to community center may not be what is needed and what should be done, and may not be based on his skill set, what he wants to do. So I think he definitely needs to know what he wants to do, or talk with someone. He can talk to me. He can get my number. He can call me and figure out what he wants to do, and then go from there.
All right.
Another thing you can do is contact the YMCA or Feeding Tampa Bay. The YMCA has a whole range of projects that they're interested in, and they are usually embedded in community centers and different areas of all of Tampa. And Feeding Tampa Bay is another great resource to start.
And a good organization also is the Big Brother.
Big Brother, Big Sister. Absolutely.
As well.
Yeah, there's a lot of different, depending on what you actually, Chris, what you actually be into. If you're you know, into helping kids, there's lots of organizations. If you're into helping the elderly, there's, you know, a Project Ship that comes out of the women's, the center down on Swan. But it's in South Tampa. So there's a lot of different things. We're going to move on with our show, but Chris, you do have an open invitation to the Urban Cafe, so make sure you give us a call, you know, come, and we'll set up a date where you can come in and hang with the Urban Cafe crew. So, to our topic today, we are going to be talking about jerks at work. So Everyday Ethics is a weekly podcast hosted by Craig, featuring media
ethicist
Kelly McBride of the Ponter Institute, and medical ethicist Art Kaplan of NYU's Long Gone Medical Center. It airs on this station every Wednesday at 2:06 p.m. So we'll get started right after this short break. We're going to talk about that. We'll be right back. You're listening to the Urban Cafe.
Good morning, Urban Cafe. WMNS 88.5. Listen to the Urban Cafe.
This is a public affairs show, and we like to talk about things that are going on in the community.
We are moving at a very fast pace. The last 10 years, there's been dramatic changes in society, and technology is at the root of that.
So we have so many conversations, and of course, we're going to want your calls at 813-239-9663.
I'm really going to do the wrong thing here. I'm going to try to put words in Ebony's mouth, but I'm going to see if I...
Oh, don't put them in my mouth.
I'm going to look the other way again. Okay. A big thank you to everyone who volunteered and pledged during our membership drive. The WMNF family really appreciates that, and we all came together. Everyone really came through, and we were able to do so many great things and meet our overall goal, and we couldn't do it without you. So thank you so much for that.
WMNS 88.5 Tampa.
You're about to listen to the Urban Cafe.
Every Sunday morning at 9 a.m., just like breakfast at Big Mama's house, we get together at the table to enjoy conversations with food for thought and lots of laughs. The community issues are addressed at our community table here on Community Radio, 88.5 FM. WMNF, every Sunday morning, this is where you should be.
Support from WMNF comes from our members and the Strass Center, presenting Soul Crooners to a celebrations of music that ushered in a new era of soul during the 70s, takes on Marvin Gaye's Heard It Through the Grapevine, Ain't No Sunshine by Will Withers, and Dancing Machine by the Jackson 5. Soul Crooners 2 is May 5th through the 15th. More at StrassCenter.org.
All right, you are back tuning into the Urban Cafe. I'm your host, Valtrinda, for today. And we're talking about jerks at work. If you're just now joining us, make sure you are able to see us, hear us on Facebook Live. Like and share. It only takes about 2 seconds to hit that button. All you have to do is hit like and then share it. Make sure that you're...
Why should they hit like?
Because we want to make sure that you are liking our show. We're bringing great information to the community. And this information...
And the more likes you get, the higher profile...
Exactly.
Is our show.
Right. So if you, the more you like it, the more other people will be able to see it on their timeline. I mean, on their news feed. So you want to make sure that you're hitting that like and share, and make sure that you are sharing. sharing this information. Don't be stingy, okay? Share this information with your friends and family.
And tell Bruce you need to like it. We know you're here every week. So
yeah,
you need to
like it.
Like it. Everybody tune in. Hit that little like thumb button right there on your right.
Hit it. All
right.
So, again, we were talking about jerks at work. All right. And so you guys have to forgive me. I'm mispronouncing a lot of words. I'm a little bit sick, so I'm trying to bring it 100%, but it ain't working that way. The show that's on every week, Wednesday at 2:06 here on WMNF, is called Everyday Ethics. That show is led by Craig Kopp, who is the general manager here. So that particular show, they did it back in January, and it was called Jerks at Work. And they had a regular conversation about toxic workers and the issues surrounding them. So we're going to go into our first clip. And our first clip is...
Today, we're heading toward the workplace. Everybody has experienced this. There are those workers that you absolutely love. They do the best job. They try to help out. They're team players. And then there's that guy or that girl who's always bad-mouthing somebody. The guy who takes credit for everything, even if he was on vacation the week it happened. They're the jerks at work.
All right, welcome back. So let's talk about that. The jerks at work. So we've got tons and tons of jerks.
I'm standing in one right now. He just came in. Hey, Nola.
Oh, wow. Nola just walked in. We already knew. Me and DT setting up this show. We already knew there was going to be some shade throwing today being here. So everybody say good morning to Nola, the host temporarily of the Sunday Forum.
Nola.
So he's just in here just saying hello to everybody. Came in knocking stuff over and all kind of stuff. Just being a jerk. So what did you guys think about that clip?
Well, we all got them. I mean, they're there everywhere. Being in the military is really hard because a lot of people want to take credit because they want that next eval. They want that next promotion. They want to, how do I get recognized? But I just actually got in trouble because my master chief, he was like, well, McKinley, since you have this type of award. And I was like, you know what, honestly, I just do my job and I don't even worry about that. And he was like, no, wrong answer. Like, you should be tracking what you're doing and whatnot. And I'm just like, I come from the adage of when it doesn't matter who takes credit for an assignment, more things can get done. So to me, I mean, and there are those people. But for me, I'm just like, you know what? I don't care. You know, we'll just get the mission done and then move on. Where other people are like, oh, well, I did such and such. And you're just like, man, really? Is it really that serious?
Yeah, but you might be the exception that proves the rule, though. I think even in, like, I haven't been in the military, but I've been in, like, an office setting, you know, and there are people that used to, at least, when everything wasn't digital, they'd stand by the printer, right? People in sales stand by the printer, and when people printed their orders in, they'd be the first to grab them. So they'd boost their sales. And they get the bonus. And they, you know, and what do you do? And then,
well, that's competitive. I think we're talking about, like, brown nosing and being just abrasive at work. Are we talking about
that? Let's give a clear definition of what jerk is.
Okay.
All right. It's an obnoxious person, a stupid person, or a person who is not well liked or who treat others badly. So that's a particular, that's a definition of the word jerk. Low.
And to Sam's point, that could be an obnoxious person that's standing there that's trying to, you know, hone in on all the work and so forth. But I remember reading an article and it talked about how there are certain people, jerks, that are toxic in the environment, and those are the ones who excel. You know, it's not necessarily that they're brown-nosing, actually. The bosses know that they're jerks, but they're very competitive and they're very efficient, yeah. And they get the work done. And those are the ones to excel many times.
Yeah, well, we're going to go to our next clip, but I want to make sure, I want to ask you guys a question. How many of you have actually held a job where you're feeling like you're working in a toxic environment at work? Okay, so they can't see, other than Facebook Live, they can't see you raise your hand.
Yes.
So that's one for Phil, that's yes. One for Jamal. Okay, Jamal?
Well, my environment is toxic, but it doesn't bother me. I'm probably the jerk at work, too. We
yeah,
all are.
I can believe that.
Give him a round of applause for that.
well, what I mean is not like in my workplace, as in my physical office, but in my profession, we're all jerks. Unfortunately, that's how we're viewed. We don't see it that way.
What do you do for a living?
Yeah, what is it that you do? What is it?
I advocate for the rights of individuals.
But you're a lawyer, right?
Yeah, we're Esquire.
I'm a lawyer. All right, let's go to our second clip, and we want you guys to make sure you're commenting on Facebook, on Facebook Live. If you are tuned in on your radio, make sure you give us a call. The phone number is
813-239-9663, or send us a text at 813-433-0885.
All right, so we're going to our second clip.
What you've got are people who do bad things, but they're cold, calculating, they're suck-ups. They basically are strategists who say, you know, I'm going to get credit for everybody else's work and so on, but I'm going to stay here late and be seen as the hard worker, and I'm going to do things that basically are Machiavellian. Then it starts to make sense. And it does seem to me, if you're just really a horrid worker, you're going to get fired if you don't do anything, or you physically assault people in the workplace, that you won't last. So if you're a real jerk and you want to sort of climb fast in the corporate hierarchy, then you've got to do it in a clever way. You've got to plot and scheme, but you can't be overtly toxic. That won't work. You've got to be sneaky and slimy, and what was it in Harry Potter? You've got to be from the House of Slytherin. I mean, you got to really think this through as to how you're going to make your fast climb to the top. And as the article points out, there's a lot of success. If you're good at it, you can make it.
All right. So what do you guys think about that one?
I love the House of Slytherin.
Right on. That went right with it, right? Yeah. So the article that they're speaking of is from this Harvard Business School, and it's related to the research of 50,000 workers from various companies in order to create a profile on toxic workers. So what's wrong with working harder than everyone else in order to get ahead? What's wrong with that?
Nothing. Well, the problem, I think, is with the toxic workplace is what we're talking about here is when you work hard and everybody else, but you let everybody else know that they're not working as hard. You let the bosses know, oh, I'm doing my job, but this project would have been better if Bob would have did this or that.
Yeah.
Phil?
Yeah.
It's a thin line between doing what you want to do, doing your job, and also being politically correct in the workplace. That plays a huge role in it, because you can't say the wrong thing and it's going to hurt somebody's feelings, and it's just like, really? I don't did you do your job?
So that leads me to my follow-up question. How do you deal with someone who's like that and not jeopardize your position at work?
I've had to learn to shut up.
That, I mean, that works for you.
I have to.
Well, you know what, you hold that person accountable, right? Because if you shine a light, because let's just assume you've got a job to do and everybody's got their task, right? When you go to the meetings and you do an eval or an evaluation, right, and see how it's going, be sure to point out, if it was like me, you'd point out everything that person that's the toxic force in your workplace, point out everything didn't do wrong, but maybe didn't do efficiently and caused you extra work. Or
yeah,
other
but
people
you don't think you're nitpicking? Because, you know, if I'm your supervisor, if you come to me, I'm going to be like, okay, but, I mean, at a certain point, we all have to be adults at work.
Right.
But it depends on, like I say, everything is situational. There is no black and white in this. Everything is a gray area. But if I'm a supervisor and I'm like, okay, well, you know, you may not like what he's doing, and it also depends on what you're doing. Like in the military, there's highs and lows about what's severe and what's not. You know, some things could be about saving lives, but for the normal job, you could be like, well, you know, he may be a little bit abrasive, or he may be a little bit of a jerk, but he's getting the job done. So what is he really doing that's bothering you that much?
How about esprit de corps? Right, so he's making it not pleasant for everyone else to work there.
True. Right? I mean, the morale is definitely huge in the workplace, but everyone's here to do a job. You're not here to make friends. Everyone here is here to do a job. Lo,
I would say this. I would say that it does as far as kind of you know, go after. Kill them with kindness, I should say, as well. But not just that, you know, because sometimes you have to be firm with people and put your foot down. But yeah, definitely still be cordial, be professional. You know, if you want to kill them with kindness and use that, you know, adage or what have you, then do so. But also, I would say, you know what? As far as shed the light on the person that's being toxic, and whether they're being toxic directly to you or not, then, you know, just basically, in a sense, kind of praise yourself or bring out your attributes and what you've done and say, hey, you know what, Bob is a toxic person, right? Hey, Bob, you know, I know you handled it this way, and I appreciate you doing that. You actually gave me a competitive spirit, and I handled it this way. You know, you have to kind of shine the light on that person, too, and kind of put you on that same level as that person.
You got
to
confront them.
So let's read some of the comments on Facebook Live. Bruce says, some bad behavior must be reported as a violation of discrimination in the workplace. And he also says, open your mouth and risk potential consequences. You are at work. It's called work. Not going to play. Tammy says, can we call or email Jamal if we need a lawyer to assist us in workplace inequalities? All right, so Ty and Tanika, good morning, Ty and Tanika. Thank you for tuning in on Facebook.
They say
he's right. Oh, I'm sorry. He right. It's hard to express what people do wrong because other. Okay, I'm going to need you guys, if you're on Facebook, try to write or spell check and stuff because I'm reading these on air. He's right. It's hard to express what people do wrong because other people see it differently. I think that's what they're trying to say. They also say not when the supervisor likes that person, which is going to bring me to our next clip.
Our segue game is on point today.
Yeah, no kidding.
Let's say you're the boss. You're the manager or leader or the captain of the team, and you have to deal with this. Take a listen.
Well, so your boss wants a group of people that are more like you and not the toxic worker. That toxic workers actually are better than average when it comes to productivity. And that's why they get away with it, right? Because you fire people when they don't meet the expectations of the job. But you can't necessarily fire somebody for being toxic. You can't fire them for being mean or for being a bully or for being a gossip or being Debbie Downer. You measure productivity based on the tasks that you've asked the person to perform. Now, all of those things can affect productivity, but they're not going to affect your own productivity if you're the one causing them. They're going to affect the productivity of everybody around you.
All right, so if you're just now tuning in to the Urban Cafe WMNF Tampa, we're talking about jerks at work. And again, these clips that we're playing, they have come from the show that plays every Wednesday at 2, which is called Everyday Ethics, which is led by
12:15.
Oh, it says 2. 12. I'm sorry, 12:06. So I've been saying 2 all day. So it's Wednesdays at 12.
You're half right.
Wednesdays at 12. I was just missing the one. And this particular show, again, it's called Everyday Ethics, led by our general manager, Craig Copp. So they're talking about this particular topic, jerks at work. So let's go in reference to our third clip. How would you, or what would you say to your superior in order to bring this problem to their attention?
Can I address something else before we?
Go ahead.
I'm gonna. So let's take this to the extreme, right? So a toxic worker is more productive than a non-toxic worker. I think that's what she said, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So take that to the extreme. Imagine your whole workforce is made up of toxic workers. Now, how do you think that's going to play out?
It depends on
productivity. Yeah, it would be great.
It depends on what you're doing.
Everybody fighting against one another and all trying to be the top dog and be the teacher's pet and all that. Right. I can't imagine that. So I don't think managers are thinking that through when they're thinking, he's a little abrasive or she's a little abrasive sometimes, but he's so super productive. We need more of these people in here. And then you start laying off or giving bad reviews for people who aren't as productive, and then you have this whole workforce of just evil people.
Well, to get to what the original question was, like for this particular segment, I think it depends on if you're the manager. Managers don't do the work. You're about managing a team, and that's what a lot of people fail to realize. So everyone has to kind of know their role, in my opinion. Everyone has to know their role. Okay, do your job, do this, do that, because where that jerk is going to excel, that jerk is also going to fail somewhere else. So if everyone is, as a manager, if you can, number one, identify everybody's strengths and weaknesses, let them know what their strengths and weaknesses are, it could be productive. The problem is I think everything is going to be based off of production, because if you have a jerk in the workplace and they're not producing, well, then it becomes a problem. You see what I'm saying? So I think we need to take that dynamic into effect as well. What if the person who's so nice, who's getting walked over, is the best producer for you? Well, then how do you flip that? How do you address people in that way?
Jamal?
Just to address the text, I don't practice unemployment law. I'm sorry, employment law per se, but I do practice some aspects of it, so I can get them in contact with another attorney. But also, I think looking at the bigger bigger picture is it's the overall production of the team. Like if you have a toxic worker and they can be, let's say, producing like at a 95% rate, others at 60%, but if they're affecting other people to the fact, to the point where they're lowering the other people's productivity, then you're a toxic worker no matter how productive they are. They make actually worse for your team.
Right.
So that's kind of hard to figure out, engage.
Well, that was my point, though. Yeah. I mean, if you just keep hiring toxic workers, yeah, your production will go up temporarily.
It's also perception, too. For example, and I had this one job where a supervisor would always call up to our shop, and you always heard me in the background kind of laughing, ha, ha, ha. And he's like, it seemed like Phil was always laughing and everything, and he talked to my supervisor. He's like, is Phil producing? He's like, absolutely. He's like, Phil's one of my best guys. He's like, oh, so then why is he always? He's like, because Phil likes his job, and we have fun on this team. Because, you know, they're in the outside room, and so the only thing they can do is call in. But I enjoy my job. I love my job, and we were having fun. So even though it seems like on the outside looking in, oh, it was so toxic. And it was said, no, really, it didn't. So your perception.
Well, why
really
in every job application that you ever get into, it has two questions, or application or interview. It has two things: are you a team player, and how do you work well solo?
Yeah,
right.
But who's going to say no to that?
So, yeah, no, but I'm just saying
because it seems like there are certain jobs who you know that you need to be able to do work together. There are certain jobs where everybody's strictly on their own. So it depends on what is catered to that particular job. So everybody's going to say that they're a team player. You know, hey, I work together. But that doesn't
But it's important, though, to have a team player because it's about a team. I'm the thinking that it's a tortoise and the hare. So you may have whatever. But the tortoise is like slowing down. He sees the end of the ring. He knows, and the hare is just blasting by. And the hare takes off. Right? We all know that. So I think steady wins the race. Well, I think is what it is. And you have the hare in there.
Let me say this. Lowe's pretty low key, right? So Lowe, if you were a supervisor, and you had, I'll be the jerk, of course. And then you had like Jamal. If he was like low key, like how would you do that? How would you spend that for somebody like me who could be considered abrasive?
Well, I believe what I would do with you is to highlight your strong points, but definitely point out what I see to be as negative. You know, not necessarily to state what Jamal said, and Jamal told me, no, because I don't think that's going to be effective. You know,
because I won't listen at that point. But if my supervisor is saying, hey, Phil, okay, I see what you're saying. Go ahead.
Right, but just basically to highlight your strong points and point out things that I believe that you can improve of as far as, you know what, you know, your communication can be better here. You know, people look at you as a leader. If you speak to them in this such a way, in this tone, you know, you'll definitely get a greater response.
Jamal?
Yeah, and it's not to... I know Phil mentioned nitpick, not to nitpick, but like I tell a lot of my clients, people in general, I'm an evidence person. People now say a lot of things. They say this, they say that. But if I have recordings, if I have text messages, if I have emails, you can't get out of that.
Right. Bruce says that the toxic worker term actually means nothing legally. So if you were the boss, which is the question on the floor, how would you deal with the toxic worker, being that them being toxic is really, they're not doing anything illegal, they're not doing anything outside of their job description. If anything, they're probably the most productive person there. Let's also read what Marlon says. Marlon says, team and staff meetings are valuable. It's up to the leader of your team to hold everyone accountable and doing their job correctly. Thank you for that, Marlon. Tammy says, it's far more difficult when you're the boss having to deal with different personalities. Holding each person equal accountable is harder than it sounds.
Absolutely.
You know, often in a work environment, at least I feel, they have the term, you got to manage your manager. And some people don't want to do that. They come in and it's for the paycheck. I'm only in it for the money. I'm here 9-to-5 mentality, blah. But if you really want to get ahead and you want to, you know, make your 8 hour a day a little cushier, right? Then you manage your manager. You make sure that whatever your problem is, your manager thinks it's her problem or his problem, and you do it collectively, right? So you manage the expectations of your manager.
I think we also can look at the dynamics of each individual. Like if we're still looking at it from the management perspective, you have to look at everyone for who they are and how they produce or how they don't produce. Like, knowing your team, in my opinion, again, is huge, because you may need somebody like Phil. Like, okay, you know what? I need my pit bull for this one. Phil, go ahead. Or you need somebody like Lowe who can come up in a first approach a situation very nice, very this, that, and the third. And then when that doesn't work, then you're like, okay, I know I can send in Phil for this. I got to send. You know, you have to know your people. And that's really, in my opinion, what a leader does.
So what do you say? So a toxic worker could, the toxic worker,
you can mitigate worker based upon the management. It's really, because if everyone's equal on the playing field and we're all working at the same job, it's the manager's job to manage that team.
What if the manager is the toxic worker?
Amen.
That's harder.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
That's a good question.
And then you have this whole team who has to basically follow behind this manager, the toxic worker.
Take antibiotics every morning.
I just play devil's advocate just a little bit, because I'm in a job where a lot of people, a lot of people, in essence, I mean, we have very, very thick skin. So is everybody just being sensitive?
Well, yeah, and see, I get things
on a daily basis. I mean, from different judges, different attorneys, like, everybody's toxic.
Yeah, but what if you're?
I see what you're saying. If I'm the manager with thick skin and I'm allowing everybody to just run wild,
how is the employee feeling comfortable? Or I'm being affected, even though you think I'm being sensitive, my work is being affected by this toxic worker. Mm-hmm. And if you think I'm just being sensitive, that's not true. Look at how I'm producing. If I'm not producing, and it's not due to my work, it's due to this toxic worker. I'm not pointing at you, though. Then am I really being sensitive? Or, I mean, what do we do to get back to the fact so I can produce?
So basically, going back to your question as far as how do you handle a toxic manager, myself being, again, I feel like I'm a natural born leader, and I don't know how to follow as well. But with that said, if I recognize that I have a toxic leader, then I'm going to, as far as be that person, that team leader in a sense, that senior person, and I'm going to state to that you know, manager, hey, you know, why don't we, you know, try speaking to the crowd this way, or can I lead this part of the meeting? And then, you know, as far as does everyone, you know, and get the others involved, mm-hmm. and see how they are receptive to me. And so you know, the leader has nothing, he can't do anything but follow suit,
right? Marlon says on Facebook Live, if the manager is toxic, get your resume together. That too. Tammy says, true that, Marlon.
Yeah, so, well, if the manager is toxic, you got 4 years before you can transfer. You got a problem.
All right, so it may or may not be a surprise that some people want to lead, like Lo says, some people try to lead and some are born leaders. Some leaders should not even be in a relationship role, because I'm sorry, in a leadership role. I'm a relationship there. Not even to be in a leadership role because they lack leadership skills or leadership qualities, which leads me to my next clip.
And managers a lot of times just put their heads in the sand and ignore the toxicity because the productivity is there, not recognizing that they really do. If you're the boss, you have an obligation to try and create a healthy workplace. And paying attention to toxic workers is really hard. I mean, I have some ideas on what you can do if you're in a workplace to address toxic workers, because every workplace has them, but none of them are super easy.
The problem that you address there about, well, they're productive, but they're toxic and they cost the company in more ways than you can count and actually see. But the problem is that, you know, how does one attack someone who's productive? Their argument is, what are you talking about? I'm doing a good job. As a matter of fact, I'm doing a better job than some of the other people here.
The managers that I've seen that successfully address this are the ones that can have conversations with the toxic worker about the thing or the things that he or she is doing that make that person toxic.
All right, welcome back to the Urban Cafe. We are, if you're just tuning in, we're talking about jerks at work, which these clips, again, came from our show on Wednesdays at 12, led by Craig. So what do you guys think about that? Let me ask a question before you guys respond. What do you feel when the boss is afraid of the bully? How do you, if you're the boss and there's a bully, toxic worker, how do you handle that when they're afraid of them?
If I was the boss, or if I see that my boss is afraid,
No. If you are the boss.
Oh, I'm not. No.
If you can't identify.
If you're
can't
the boss.
I can't either.
I can't identify.
Well, if you're the boss. Okay, let me ask this question. Have you ever had a boss that seemed like they didn't want to deal with obvious issue because they were afraid?
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
So we have dealt with that.
Yes.
Okay. All right. So what are you guys' thoughts on that clip?
Boss, let me get it.
That's my
view. You have any thoughts on this?
Boss, let me get this one.
Yeah.
Let me talk to him.
Well, before you do that, we need you guys to call in. If you are listening, tuned in, the phone number is
813-239-9663.
And we have a text line, so if you don't want to be heard on air or you don't want to type in on Facebook, you can text.
813-433-0885.
All right, so Phil, what's your response?
Well, if I feel like if my boss is scared, then I will literally say, hey, look, because I'll be, if I'm not the top dog, if I'm not the leader, then please believe I'm going to have the leader's ear because I'm a natural leader. So I would say, okay, look here, this is where we at. We got this situation, we got that situation. And it's like, oh, well, you know, we don't... Okay, let me talk to him then. I'm letting you know I came to you first, but do you mind if I speak to him? Because it's not going to happen. Because if I can't make the decision, I'm going to influence the decision one way or another.
Well, then to me, it's going to come off that you're going to now be the jerk at work.
That's fine. But I'm the jerk for the right cause. Because if I'm standing up for my people and my team, then I'll be that all day.
And what if that goes left?
Because I'm probably addressing the issue because someone else, and I get in trouble for this sometimes, I'll admit, I'll say things that other people won't say. Mm-hmm. I've gotten in trouble for that, and that's fine, but that's what a leader does. Sometimes it's not going to be viewed as the right thing, but if it's the necessary thing, if it's a just thing, I'll do it, no problem.
Jamal? You're supposed to have it together.
I'm trying to think of how to say this in the nicest way possible.
Okay.
Businesses are supposed to make money. That's what they're in business for. Mm-hmm. So... unfortunately, I don't think they really care about a toxic worker and people's feelings.
But everything can be losing money.
They
can be losing money if they are the toxic worker. If it's a team of five and there's one toxic worker and four others are affected by this one person, then they are losing money.
Well, I'll give you a great example of what I mean by this. It all depends on the workplace environment. Now, this could be an extreme example. It's very rare, but the Los Angeles Lakers, Kobe Bryant just retired, favorite player in the NBA. Kobe Bryant is very toxic. It's very known. And people don't like him, don't want to work with him. Some players didn't go there because of he was there. But the Lakers, and you know, he has a manager above him and a coach. But as a player, what are you going to do? Go complain to the coach or the general manager? Kobe, you know, he's not being not passing the ball. And they're like, look, we like it, Kobe, what do you mean?
Me and Kobe would.
I think it depends on how productive the other person is. Because if the person is at a productivity rate to a point where they productivity really trumps everybody else's, mm-hmm. where the company's still making more and more money, then...
Well, Tama, every workplace environment doesn't have to revolve around profit. Like, you can have a non-profit organization. This right here is a job, so it doesn't necessarily have to always be about money.
That's true.
I do want to make that distinction. Work is work.
Because there may be... Let's use us for an example, okay? Hypothetically speaking, this is a non-profit organization. I think that we all know that, right?
Yes. Yes.
So we're all basically volunteers. However, we work together. Mm. Now, if there's one person on this team that was very toxic and they weren't doing, do you think that it would affect others, especially with us being on air, where if someone is a jerk or someone is being toxic and to another teammate, do you think that that would affect somebody's their job that particular day?
Oh, trust and believe. Sure, DT, we'll talk to you.
Yeah.
DT.
Well, you'll get asked, right? But I think if you're in a job environment, that's why I think there's a distinction in the productivity. Even when you're a non-profit, you're still making money,
right?
Right. Mm-hmm. But you're making just enough money to live,
right?
Right. But in a
I think it's all the same. I just wanted to make the distinction that every work doesn't have to be based off of production for money. Production is production.
But to your point, Jamal, when you see that the production and the productivity goes up, that's short term, especially when you're working in a team environment, because it's going to affect the other four people. It just will. And maybe it'll even affect the manager and Valtran.
All right. So Marlon says, sorry, but Death Row Records had a toxic manager / boss, and they haven't been the same since. Right, DT?
Listen, I used to love Suge Knight.
Not no more. Hey. End of story.
He broke up the dynasty. You had a good team.
Well, speaking of Marlon, you know, right. Marlon, you've seen what happened with Ramir and then Late Night Noise Crew and Channel 7, the TV show. There it is.
Okay. So Ty says she or he, it's because it says Ty and Tanika. I've got one now, and she doesn't do anything. How do you address her without getting fired? And I think that's what we talked about a little bit earlier. How do you address, you know, the manager about the toxic worker and not put your job in jeopardy? All right. And so we want to welcome Kojak Shaheem that's just joined us in on Facebook. So listen, we've got another clip. Okay. If you want to call in, give us a phone number and text number, Phil.
813-239-9663 is our phone number. And our text is 813-433-0885.
All right. So we're going to take a quick break. We've got a little bit more than 10 minutes left in our show. We will be right back. You're listening to The Urban Cafe, WMNF Tampa.
Well, with social media and my age group, they have pretty much slandered Donald Trump on Twitter specifically.
So the young people don't love Donald Trump?
They do not agree with anything.
Does anyone think this guy could be a great president or a good president, at least?
I think he would be similar to Nixon, but even worse.
Thanks.
So they say, oh, let's make America great again. What? How was America not great? If you still have a roof over your head, running water, and you eat at least a meal a day, you are still better off than 75% of the population of the world.
Is there a time more important than now to understand what the Muslim world is all about? Know the world talk you're talking about. Listen to True Talk Friday mornings at 10 on WMNF Community Conscious Radio for Tampa Bay.
All right, so you're tuned in to the Urban Cafe. Now listen, Facebook Live is popping today. We haven't had anybody call in, so I know you're out there. I know that you are
Zeb.
In a situation where you're at work, maybe not right now, but you have a job where there is a toxic worker. Maybe you're not calling in because you don't want to put yourself out there and then go to work Monday morning.
You can remain anonymous.
We take anonymous phone calls.
Anonymous phone calls.
But we will keep it anonymous. You can change your voice if you want to, but do give us a call so we can hear from you, the community. And then we want to hear from you about how we can, like the question that Ty and Tanika asked, what if I am in a situation where there is a toxic worker and, you know, I want to go to the manager, but I don't want to put my position. So that's the question out there for you guys who are listening, for you to call in. Phil, give us that. Maybe they're not calling because Tina isn't giving the number. Why don't you put it up? Put your Tina voice on.
Oh, gosh.
813-239-9663.
And our text, Tina?
813-433-0885.
The visual on this is amazing. He's like leaning and rocking. He's gotten into character.
I'm getting into character.
All right. So we do have a caller.
Yay!
Mark out of Tampa. Mark, thank you for calling into the Urban Cafe. What's your comment?
Yeah, this is Mark Bureau.
Hey,
hi. Listen, I just wanted to say that in my experience, being 65, but looking like 29.
All right.
What you
and
say?
As my wife says, acting like I'm 6. My experience has shown me that the most toxic person in a workforce has usually been the boss. I've always felt that, you know, boss spelled backwards is double S-O-B.
Wow.
And, you know, that's the hardest person to reach. And in the case that you guys are talking about, it's hard to make him understand that a person in the workforce is toxic. Usually the people in the workforce handle the toxic person themselves. But when the boss can't see it, boy, that's really toxic.
We definitely agree with that, and I think it's been known that we do agree with that. But we want to personally thank you,
Mark,
for calling in. Thank
you. See you guys later.
All right. Hey, Mark.
Yes.
Hey, why don't you give us a plug for your show?
Oh, well, I'm on Tuesday from 12 to 1, but anybody with sense would never listen to.
that's cue for listen to his show. Right. Tuesdays at 1, everybody. Thank you again, Mark.
Bye-bye.
So as we know, real quick, the workplace can be very competitive environment, and bullies can come in all different colors, sizes, and genders. But how do we deal with the bullies? So let's go to our fifth soundbite, and then we're going to come back and comment on that.
A lot of times when you have a bully in the workplace, they often don't realize how intimidating they are. They fully intend to be intimidating, but they don't realize how intimidating they are. And a good manager will talk to that person about his body language or his demeanor in a meeting or his demeanor in a one-on-one conversation and try and bring self-awareness to that person. If you've got a person who's just always complaining, you can talk to that person and say, here's all the complaints that you gave me in the last 5 minutes. Can you start to pay attention to that and do it less? It's really hard because these types of behaviors are ingrained in people and hard to change. And as a manager, you spend a lot of time and energy, but it's totally worth it. And I think part of the moral obligation of a manager who really cares about his staff.
Right. Thank you. Thank you for tuning in again to the Urban Cafe. We're talking about jerks at work. Now, what would you say to someone who has been seen as a bully, but they don't necessarily bully you? How does that conversation sound like, Lo?
I think what I would do, and it kind of goes back to what Phil stated earlier, even though he self-described me as low-key, which is cool, but I can be a pit bull too.
I like it.
But it goes to your point, Valtrin, or your question. I feel in that situation, what I would do, I feel to a certain degree, public shaming is helpful, and it can influence change of behavior. So in a subtle sense, though, mm-hmm. in a professional subtle sense. So what I would do, even though my boss may not be leading that charge, I would just basically, I'll be the person. I'm going to be the cultural diversity person and create that comfortable atmosphere for everyone, that cohesion. Right. And in doing so, that is going to call out the bully, and it's kind of forces them to change and to get on board.
Okay, Phil?
I mean, I feel like I said, I told you before, I get in trouble for speaking up for people who won't speak up for themselves, and especially if that person's on my team. Like, if you're on my team, then you're on my team. We may joke around, but can't nobody else joke around. If I see somebody, even if it is the boss, I'll step to the boss myself and say, all right, look, like, seriously, we got to change this. Because in where I am, sometimes we have people who are put into leadership positions when they are definitely not ready, and they get that power hungry, I'm the boss, and you do this, you do that. I'm just looking at you like, okay, we can either do this the easy way, we can do this the hard way. Either you can fix this, or I'll be the one who will start a ride up in this bad boy. We can take this thing over.
So we often have conversations on this particular show. Thank you guys for that comment. On this particular show about relationships. It says relationships for real this time, Sam.
Sure. Look
at me. Whether it's with our significant other or with a friend or even with a sibling, everybody deserves respect regardless of our personal afflictions. Let's take a listen to this clip and we're going to wrap things up for today.
Kelly, let's say you're not a manager. You're a worker. You don't do the politics game well. I can't think of one job that I've ever had that didn't have politics involved in it, office politics in some way, shape, or form. Do you need to learn some politics, or is there another thing you can do?
You need to learn relationship skills. Mm. I counsel so many young, hard workers who come in, and they do. They get their work done really well, but they don't build relationships. And in a more toxic environment, that hurts you because people aren't giving you credit for what you're doing. But even in a less toxic environment, it undermines your ability to advance because nobody knows you. Nobody knows what you want. And you're also not finding opportunities, which is to help other people. It's never just about the work. Relationships are always more important in the workplace than the actual work.
So not always be closing, always be building relationships.
Always be talking.
Always be talking.
So, always building relationships. So if you you are the jerk at work and you're out there, maybe you should kind of take a look in the mirror and pretty much listen to what everybody else is saying about, hey, you know, you are a little bit toxic here, and we want to build a better relationship at work, because we want not just one of the teammates to be productive, but we want all of them to be productive. What's your comment, Jamal, on that particular clip?
Well, my comment is, you know, when it comes to the politics, that's just natural, like you said, relationship building. But I think one big thing I think that people should strive to do is, what Mr. Bureau said is, if you have a teamwork where you other people who are not toxic talk, you guys can kind of outsmart the bully, toxic worker, and you can avoid a confrontation with the actual manager.
All right, so let's read some of our Facebook comments before we have to leave you guys for today. Marlon says, you are only as good as your team. He says, my man DT always said, surround yourself with a great team of people, and your team and your goals will be achieved. Let's just, I mean, that comment particularly was great. First of all, I mean, we do work with an amazing, amazing team leader, and DT, I know he doesn't like a lot of, you know, cheering and, you know, hovering over how good he is, but he is good, and he makes sure that our team stays untoxic, if that's a word. Nobody else is saying anything because they're all the jerks at work.
Constant detox.
Yeah, that's a good one. So Tammy says, employees never avoid confrontation at work, mainly because they can't afford to be fired, and they love what they do. Dealing with toxic workers or managers or leadership choosing not to deal with these issues. Tammy also says, are really the issues someone needs to give advice on each situation. So we want to thank everybody for tuning in today to the Urban Cafe. We definitely want you guys to go to www.wmnf.org and hit that tip jar. That's for you guys on Facebook Live. That's for you guys listening in your car. Make sure you're tuned in every Sunday, 9 a.m. And then go back on Facebook and push the replay button. You can always listen again. Share it on your friends so that all your friends can see it. And then we will be having our next show next Sunday, 9 a.m. We'll be here. You guys can call, text, join us on Facebook Live. We have our drive coming up. I don't have the date, but it's in June. It's in June. So, yeah, stay tuned for that. You've been listening to The Urban Cafe. I'm your host for today, Val Trenda. And
Thank you. Jason, Brian Davis, DJ Clue, Tammy for commenting, Edwin, Craig Cobb, Tyann, Marlon Moore. Thank you guys again. Stay tuned. WMNF Tampa.
Live from NPR News in Washington.
President Obama is in Germany. He's scheduled to be meeting with Chancellor Angela Merkel right now as the two host the world's largest.
Didn't she say, Angela Merkel, I think it was 2008, how hot Obama was? She couldn't wait to meet him when he was coming over there campaigning.
Who?
Angela Merkel, the Chancellor of Germany. Yeah, that's where he's going today with.
You better take Michelle with him.
Yeah.
So, how you feel on the show?
I feel good. Feel great. Except for, you know, my comments, you know, I'm a little. Because it's
you party every Saturday night, so you get here and you like a little one step behind. Is that the issue?
No, I do a lot of networking and everything.
Oh, smart.
No, but you know, it's tough. I mean, my advice, it's tough. Like, I was at Coca-Cola in Detroit. It may have been kind of toxic or whatnot, but now I don't have that. Like, I can.
Yeah.
If you feel like a toxic workplace, evidence is key. Evidence is everything.
Serving in Tampa also earlier today, signing with the then Prime Minister Alexander Vukic. Four more years of power.
The subject has changed 420.
Membership in the European Union amid opposition demands for closer ties to Russia. Some of the residents
really?
Of the Gilbert Fire and Rescue Department says the blaze started at a large apartment complex under construction.
That fire quickly spread. We had a windy night out.
The one girl
that fire
got
out.
probably about 120 to 130 firefighters.
Fire officials told local media that one firefighter suffered burns on his hands and three police officers had to be treated for smoking.
You joining the second segment?
Yeah.
Still the same second segment. What's up, Urban Cafe? Is the Supernola AJ Nope today? We're going to talk about the incident that happened in St. Petersburg, Florida, with the three girls, the three teenage girls that drowned in the cemetery pond. We'll examine that, the relationship between the public and the police department. Why there's so much mistrust? What can we do about it? You know, because on one end, if you really actually try to save the kids and you hear the narrative that's out there right now, how does that make you feel? On the other end, can you blame the public for actually thinking this way they do when someone's making comments about, oh yeah, they drowned, dude, this is 6-7 and all that stuff. And in the second segment, we're going to address the Tappan Bay Express Lane because it's picking up steam right now. So we want to talk about why there's a concerted effort by the powers that be going about going through trying to destroy Tappan Bay Heights and Seminole Heights and all that stuff for the sake of this express lane when we already have one, you know? So we want to examine the pros and cons.
Well, we're going to be ending this broadcast. How can they stay tuned to what you're doing?
Stay tuned right now. WMNF Tampa 88.5 FM is going to be the Sunday form coming right after NPR News and the Urban Cafe.
And if they're living out of town watching this on Facebook, how can they listen?
You can listen to it by logging on to WMNF.org on your smartphones and ride along and listen to us while we talk about everything else today. 10 o'clock to 12 o'clock, Sunday form. We have Heidi here, Everlasting. We're going to have Will Billy here. All right. So join us. Thank you.
Professor Razul Kareem Siddiqui was reportedly attacked from behind in the front slip with a machete.
What's up? All right, so now we're going into a post-production meeting. We have a guest who's here to talk about, we have a guest who's here to talk about May, workers' rights. We're going to be doing a show on that. And so they're here to meet us in our post-production meeting and give us a little information about the topic so we can have an informed discussion on May 1st when we talk about that. So this is the pre-production room, post-production, pre-production. This is where we hash all our details out for next show. We've all seen it before. Here's our guest.
We have a crew sitting in.
And so I am going to end this broadcast and thank you all for listening.